On September 16, 2018, tragedy struck the quiet town of Willow Creek, Maine, in a way no one could have predicted. This small suburban town, where life seemed to flow peacefully, was shaken by the horrific murder of a young man whose life was cut short far too soon. Alex Harrington, a 22-year-old fitness trainer, was found dead in one of the town's most prestigious homes. That home belonged to Daria Cross, a well-known psychologist who appeared to live an impeccable life. Willow Creek was the epitome of a typical American suburb. Beautiful houses, well-manicured lawns, and quiet streets where residents knew each other by name created a sense of safety and comfort. However, behind the facade of tranquility, there lurked an atmosphere of intrigue and jealousy that would eventually lead to tragedy. It all began on the morning of September 16th. Daria Cross's neighbors, alarmed by the unusual silence from her house for several days, called the police to report strange occurrences. Alex Harrington, whose name had been unknown to the public until that day, became the central figure in the most mysterious and sinister murder that had ever shaken this small town. Alex was young, full of energy, and had big plans for the future. He had just moved to Willow Creek from Iowa in search of a better life, like many young people. Working as a fitness trainer and training local residents, he quickly gained popularity among his clients, especially among the town's affluent women. But on September 16, 2018, the shining facade of success and ambition crumbled. The police discovered Alex's body in the pool on Daria Cross's property. What began as a simple call from concerned neighbors quickly turned into a murder case that exposed the town's darkest secrets. Who killed Alex Harrington? And how did such a bright young man find himself at the center of a sinister web of passion and control? These were the questions that police and local journalists were trying to answer. But the deeper they dug, the more tangled and frightening the details became, enveloping not just Alex's life, but the lives of many in this seemingly perfect town. Alex Harrington was born on May 12, 1996, in the small town of Clear Lake, Iowa. From a young age, he was drawn to an active lifestyle. In school, he was a star on the football team, which earned him recognition among his peers. But Alex dreamed of something more than life in a small town. In 2018, at just 22 years old, he decided to change his fate and move to Willow Creek, Maine. In Willow Creek, Alex found work as a trainer at an elite fitness club frequented by the town's wealthy and influential residents. Thanks to his natural charisma and excellent physical condition, he quickly attracted attention. His friendliness and ability to motivate people made him popular with clients, especially wealthy women. It seemed his life was on an upward trajectory. He acquired a new apartment, good connections, and promising prospects. Interviews with Alex's former clients began to emerge, with middle-aged women describing how charming and caring he was, how special he made them feel in his presence. "His clients couldn't get enough of him," recalls one of them, Cheryl Weston. "He was full of life, always helping me find a balance between training and living." Alex knew how to inspire, but behind the facade of success lay another side of Alex's life, one that few knew about. Gradually, through his interactions with a wealthy clientele, Alex became involved in the world of sugar relationships, secret connections where affluent women showered him with expensive gifts and financial support in exchange for attention and intimacy. Less than 6 months after moving to Willow Creek, Alex received his first luxurious gift, a gold chronograph worth several $1,000s from one of his clients. Following this gift came trips to upscale restaurants and designer clothing, which he flaunted on social media. His life on the surface seemed like a fairy tale: luxury, attention, and money. But with each new gift, he became more deeply entangled in a secret and dangerous game. With every new gift, Alex became increasingly dependent on these relationships. His clients were no longer just people paying for training. They became a part of his personal life. The money, which seemed easy at first, came with serious personal investments, both emotional and physical. His friend Tom, whom he had met at the gym, recalled, "He said he liked all the gifts, but sometimes it felt like he was losing himself." He complained that the women were demanding more and more of his attention, but Alex didn't know how to say no. It was like he was trapped. Every step, every expensive gift brought Alex closer to a point where his life would become a victim of the very luxury that had once enticed him. Alex didn't realize that this temptation would soon turn into a threat to his own life. Daria Cross was born on March 3, 1970, in Providence, Rhode Island, into a family of educators. From a young age, she showed a deep interest in psychology, eager to understand human nature and behavior. After earning her degree in clinical psychology in 1994, Daria quickly built a successful career, becoming a respected specialist in therapy. In the 2010s, Daria began exploring alternative healing methods and spiritual practices, including meditation, esotericism, and energy healing. Her professional life shifted toward more metaphysical practices, where she combined psychology with esoteric rituals. However, beneath the surface lay a darker side of her personality, a desire for control and manipulation. In mid-2018, just a few months before Alex Harrington's murder, Daria met him at the fitness club, where he worked as a trainer. Their first interactions were professional, but Daria soon felt an unusual attraction to him. Clients at the fitness club noticed that Daria often stayed after sessions to chat with Alex, inviting him to spiritual talks. But these conversations quickly evolved into something deeper and more troubling. Witnesses reported that Daria began exerting a strong influence on Alex, using her psychological expertise to gradually convince him that their meeting was fated. She persuaded him that they were spiritually connected and that their destinies were intertwined in shared karma. Daria told Alex that he needed to undergo a purification to achieve a higher understanding of himself and the world. Daria immersed Alex in the world of esotericism and spiritual rituals. She claimed that through him, she could heal her own karma, which had accumulated after a difficult divorce and estrangement from her parents. In July 2018, Daria began conducting spiritual cleansing sessions with Alex in her home, using various techniques, including meditation, crystals, and special ritual practices. Former colleagues of Daria recalled that she often spoke with admiration about her rituals and esoteric practices. In these conversations, she mentioned that she saw something more in Alex than just a client or friend, a vessel that would help her reach enlightenment. Daria once told me that she had found the perfect vessel through which she could cleanse her energy flows. She was always talking about these forces guiding her toward fulfilling a mission, but I thought it was just esoteric nonsense. But that nonsense soon took on horrifying forms. Daria convinced Alex that through him, she could spiritually be reborn and achieve perfection in life. She said that his sacrifice would become part of her path. Alex, trusting Daria as both a psychologist and spiritual guide, fell further and further under her influence. He started talking strangely about spiritual things he had never mentioned before. He said that Daria had shown him another side of life, but sometimes I could tell that it scared him. I think she was really messing with his head. Each day, Alex found himself deeper in the trap of her manipulation. He was bound to her not just physically, but emotionally, unaware that his trust was being exploited for her personal gain. Daria dragged him further into her cleansing rituals, claiming that it would benefit not only him, but her as well, as part of their shared karmic connection. This was not just a bond between a psychologist and her patient. It was something much darker, a combination of manipulation and the use of spiritual rituals to control someone else's life. Daria created her own reality in which Alex became her victim. September 21st, 2018 began like any other fall day in Willow Creek, a small town in Maine. However, for 62-year-old Marjorie Langston, Daria Cross's neighbor, it became the beginning of a nightmare. Marjorie noticed that Daria's house had been eerily quiet for days with the curtains drawn and no movement. Usually, Daria was active, cars coming and going, lights on late into the night, but that day something seemed off. Marjorie decided to get closer to the house to check if everything was all right. As she approached the door, she heard nothing, and when she knocked, there was no answer. She tried turning the doorknob and, to her surprise, discovered that the door was unlocked. When Marjorie stepped inside Daria's house, she immediately felt that something was wrong. The house was engulfed in an eerie silence, and there was a strange smell in the air, a mixture of incense and something much more foul. Marjorie continued down the hallway, which led to the second floor bathroom. When she opened the door, she was faced with a horrific sight. Alex Harrington's body was lying in the bathtub, his hands tied with ropes, his head submerged in the water. Around the tub were scattered strange objects, candles, crystals, and obscure symbols drawn on the floor in chalk circles. In shock, Marjorie fled from the house and immediately called the police. Within minutes, detectives John Campbell and his partner, Sarah Martin, from the Willow Creek PD arrived on the scene. It became immediately clear to them that this was not just a tragic accident. Upon arriving, the police cordoned off the house and began their investigation. All evidence pointed to the fact that Alex had not died by accident. His body bore clear signs of struggle, bruises on his wrists, lacerations on his neck and chest. The officers also discovered rope marks on his hands and feet, indicating that he had been bound before being drowned. However, the strangeness didn't stop there. Throughout the house, particularly in the bathroom, the police found signs that suggested something more sinister than just a crime of passion. Symbols drawn in chalk around the tub resembled ritualistic markings tied to occult practices. In the corner of the bathroom stood lit candles, and on the edge of the tub was a large quartz crystal, which, as investigators would later learn, Daria had used in her cleansing rituals. The investigators also noted traces of burnt incense and wax drippings from the candles, indicating the presence of some ritual. Attention was also drawn to Daria's diary, found in her upstairs bedroom, where she detailed her spiritual practices and the cleansing rituals she conducted with Alex. When we entered the bathroom, it was immediately clear that this wasn't just a murder. The surroundings and objects around the body clearly pointed to ritualistic elements. We were struck by how meticulously everything had been prepared. This wasn't a spontaneous act. It was carefully planned with a symbolic undertone, said Detective Campbell. We found symbols characteristic of occult rituals, such as ancient pagan signs and elements of esoteric practice. The items found at the scene, including crystals, candles, circles, and incense, all matched the tools Daria used for her spiritual cleansings. Now the police faced a new challenge. Was this murder driven by Daria's personal obsession, or was she following a deeper occult agenda? The symbols around the body suggested something more than just a crime of passion. But questions remained. How deeply were Alex and Daria involved in these rituals? And what really took place in that bathroom? On September 21, 2018, just hours after Alex Harrington's body was found, Detectives John Campbell and Sarah Martin began their work. From the start, the case was far from simple. Inside Daria Cross's house, investigators uncovered ritual objects, symbols, and traces of mysterious rites that led them to question the motives behind the murder. But the deeper they delved into Daria's life and her connections to Alex, the more secrets began to unravel. At first, Daria Cross remained calm. She claimed that she had last seen Alex 2 days before his death during one of their meditation sessions. But as the investigation progressed, the detectives discovered that Daria had more secrets than she was willing to admit. Examining Alex's phone records led to a shocking discovery. In addition to Daria, Alex had been maintaining a close relationship with another influential woman, Lauren Mitchell, a 45-year-old successful real estate agent from Willow Creek. Lauren was known for her wealth and connections, as well as her deep interest in esotericism. Like Daria, Lauren was involved in spiritual practices, but her connection to Alex proved to be even more dangerous. Lauren Mitchell wasn't just a wealthy real estate agent. Her involvement in spiritual practices and occult gatherings had been known in the city's inner circles for some time. It turned out that both she and Daria were members of a secret esoteric society known as the Circle of Renewal. Digging deeper into the case, detectives found references to the Circle of Renewal in Daria's home, an exclusive society made up of women who used occult rituals to gain control and power over those around them. This group was tightly knit and kept their meetings hidden from outsiders. According to the documents found, the society's members practiced magical rituals aimed at enhancing their influence in business and personal relationships. The Circle of Renewal wasn't just a spiritual gathering, it was a powerful secret society whose main goal was to achieve dominance. Their methods included meditations, magical rituals, and drawing energy through sexual connections. Alex, it seemed, became a victim of these practices used by the women of the society. This wasn't just about occult rituals for spiritual growth. It involved methods of manipulating people, using their energy, and tying them to ritualistic bonds. In Alex's case, this could have had far darker consequences. Messages found on Alex's phone revealed that Lauren was just as interested in him as Daria. She invited him to private gatherings, telling him that his presence was essential for her cleansing rituals. But what exactly these gatherings entailed remained unclear. He said he felt strange after those sessions, like he was drained. He didn't even understand what was happening, but he said it was more than just a spiritual practice. I didn't know how to help him. The more the detectives dug, the more they realized that Alex had been drawn into a dangerous game. Records of bank transfers and expensive gifts from Lauren and Daria to Alex showed that he wasn't just a part of their personal rituals. He was a crucial element in their esoteric and financial network. Secret meetings at elite homes, tied to rituals of control, had become a way for these women to achieve power and influence. Now the police had a new challenge, not just to solve Alex's murder, but to uncover the extent of the circle of renewal's influence. How far did their network reach? How many others, like Alex, had fallen victim to this dangerous game? On October 8, 2018, the investigation into Alex Harrington's murder took an unexpected turn. During a search of Daria Cross's house, the police discovered an item that had previously gone unnoticed, a leather-bound diary hidden among the books on her shelf. This diary became a key piece of evidence in uncovering the true motives behind the rituals and their participants. The detectives were stunned as they began to read Daria's entries. On those pages, she detailed the occult rituals that she and Lauren had performed together, with one chapter dedicated entirely to Alex. Daria wrote that Alex was meant to be the sacrifice in a ritual she and Lauren planned to achieve, higher spiritual power. She described the preparation process for the ritual, including the days and nights they spent meditating and cleansing Alex. Daria's writing shocked us. It clearly stated that she and Lauren were planning a ritual in which Alex was meant to play a central role. But what truly struck us were her words about the sacrifice. Daria claimed it was necessary to complete their spiritual journey. In her entries, Daria insisted that she never intended to harm Alex. She believed that through the cleansing ritual, he was supposed to become a mediator between the human world and the spiritual realm. However, as the entries progressed, they became darker, describing the failed attempts to carry out the ritual and the pressure Lauren exerted on her to complete it. Daria wrote that she felt cornered and feared exposure of her secret practices to the other members of the Circle of Renewal. However, the real bombshell came when the detectives found a hidden video recording taken on the night of Alex's murder. A camera discreetly placed in the corner of one of the upstairs rooms captured shocking footage. The video showed Lauren arriving at Daria's house on the night of September 15th. She confidently walked into the bathroom, where Alex was already bound and partially submerged in water. Lauren took control of the ritual, looking calm and authoritative. The video made it clear that Lauren was in control that fateful evening. She threatened to expose Daria's secret practices if she didn't complete the ritual. Lauren forced Daria to continue despite her doubts and fears. In the recording, you could hear Lauren commanding, "You have to do this. If you stop now, everyone will know you're a failure. You know what this will mean for you." Daria was trapped. Under Lauren's pressure, she complied and completed the ritual, which proved fatal for Alex. Lauren continued to insist that this was their only chance to complete their spiritual rebirth, and Daria, fearful for her standing in both society and the circle, followed her lead. These pieces of evidence changed the course of the investigation. On October 18, 2018, police issued an arrest warrant for Lauren Mitchell. She was charged not only with complicity in the murder, but also with manipulating spiritual rituals and using her control over Daria to achieve her own goals. Lauren did not resist arrest. She remained silent as she was taken into custody at her home. But the evidence was undeniable. The video showed that she played a central role in manipulating Daria, leading to Alex Harrington's death. Now the detectives knew that the ritual, which had begun as a cleansing, had turned into a deadly game of power and control. Alex became a victim not only of esoteric beliefs, but also of the ambitions of two women deeply immersed in their dark rituals. But questions remained. Was Daria simply a pawn in Lauren's game, or did she bear her own share of the blame? On October 20th, 2018, the investigation into Alex Harrington's murder entered a new phase. Police conducted a second search of Lauren Mitchell's house, hoping to find additional evidence of her involvement in the rituals and manipulations. During the search, they discovered a mysterious artifact that led to an unexpected revelation. In one of the closets, detectives found an ancient amulet, carefully hidden in a carved wooden box. The amulet was made of old silver, etched with engravings that matched the symbols found at the crime scene. At first, it seemed like just another esoteric item, but further analysis revealed that this artifact belonged to the head leader of the Circle of Renewal, a closed occult society in which Lauren held a high-ranking position. The amulet, it turned out, was more than just a piece of jewelry. It was an important artifact with symbolic meaning within the Circle of Renewal. Members of the society believed that it granted its owner special power, the ability to manipulate and control others' minds through rituals. This amulet symbolized authority in the highest level of spiritual knowledge, and its presence in Lauren's possession indicated her special role in the cult. This artifact was more than just a mystical relic. Lauren had been using it as a tool of influence and control over the members of her society, including Daria. We believe she considered it the source of her power and used it to manipulate those around her, forcing them to follow her commands. The hidden video, the amulet, and witness testimonies left Daria with no way out. Finally, on October 23, 2018, after long interrogations and mounting pressure, Daria Cross broke down and gave a full confession. Her voice was weak as she began to tell the truth about what had happened on the night of Alex Harrington's murder. Daria admitted that it all started with her admiration for Lauren's spiritual practices. She was in awe of Lauren's power and influence within the Circle of Renewal. Lauren convinced her that the ritual, in which Alex was to be involved, was the key to their spiritual ascension. Daria, completely captivated and under pressure, agreed to participate in the ritual, although she hadn't fully understood that Alex's death would be the result. "Lauren told me this was our chance to reach enlightenment," Daria confessed. "She convinced me that Alex had to be the sacrifice so we could cleanse our souls and ascend to a new level. I didn't want it to end in death, but Lauren made me believe it was the only way." Daria explained that for months, Lauren had manipulated her, promising spiritual ascension if she took part in the ritual. Lauren insisted that without this sacrifice, they would both remain trapped in their karma and never reach their goal. Daria was so deeply entangled in this belief system that she saw no other way but to comply. Daria's diary entries and her testimony to the detectives confirmed that Lauren had been controlling not only the ritual, but also Daria's life for months, terrorizing her and manipulating her fears. Lauren convinced her that Alex's death was a spiritual necessity, without which they would both remain trapped in their unfinished lives. In her confessions, Daria repeatedly emphasized that she didn't know the final purpose of the ritual and believed it would just be a spiritual cleansing session. However, under pressure from Lauren and the threat of being exposed to the circle, Daria felt she had no choice. On October 20th, 2018, the investigation into the murder of Alex Harrington entered a new phase. Police conducted a second search of Lauren Mitchell's house, hoping to find more evidence of her involvement in the rituals and manipulations. During the search, a mysterious artifact was discovered, leading detectives to an unexpected revelation. In one of the closets, detectives found an ancient amulet, carefully hidden in a carved wooden box. The amulet was made of antique silver with engravings that matched the symbols found at the crime scene. Initially, it seemed like just another esoteric item, but analysis revealed that this artifact belonged to the leader of the Circle of Renewal, a closed occult society in which Lauren held a high-ranking position. The amulet, it turned out, was more than just an ornament. It was a significant artifact, holding symbolic power within the Circle of Renewal. Members believed that it granted its owner special abilities, the power to manipulate and control others' minds through rituals. This amulet symbolized authority and the highest degree of spiritual knowledge, and its presence with Lauren indicated her special role in the cult. This artifact was more than a mystical relic. Lauren had been using it as a tool of influence and control over the members of her society, including Daria. We believe she saw it as the source of her power, and through it, she could manipulate others, forcing them to obey her commands. The hidden video, the amulet, and witness testimonies left Daria with no way out. Finally, on October 23, 2018, after long interrogations and pressure, Daria Cross broke down and gave a full confession. Her voice was weak as she began to reveal the truth about what had happened on the night of Alex Harrington's murder. Daria confessed that everything began with her belief in Lauren's spiritual practices. She admired Lauren's power and influence within the Circle of Renewal. Lauren convinced her that the ritual involving Alex was key to their spiritual ascension. Daria, completely captivated and under pressure, agreed to participate in the ritual, although she didn't fully understand that Alex's death would be the result. "Lauren told me this was our chance to reach enlightenment," Daria confessed. "She convinced me that Alex had to be the sacrifice so we could cleanse our souls and ascend to a new level. I didn't want it to end in death, but Lauren made me believe it was the only way." Daria revealed that for months Lauren had manipulated her, promising spiritual ascension if she participated in the ritual. Lauren claimed that without this sacrifice, they would remain prisoners of their karma and never achieve their goals. Daria was so deeply involved in this belief system that she saw no other way but to comply. Daria's diary entries and her testimony to the detectives confirmed that Lauren had been controlling not only the ritual, but also Daria's life for months, using fear and manipulation. Lauren convinced her that Alex's death was a spiritual necessity, without which they would remain trapped in their unfinished lives. In her confessions, Daria repeatedly emphasized that she didn't know the final goal of the ritual and believed it would only be a spiritual cleansing session. However, under pressure from Lauren and the threat of exposure to the circle, Daria felt she had no choice. On October 25, 2018, a month after the investigation began, Willow Creek police officially announced the double arrest in connection with the murder of Alex Harrington. Lauren Mitchell and Daria Cross were charged not only with premeditated murder, but also with participating in an illegal sect that used ritualistic practices, manipulation, and psychological abuse to achieve its goals. The double arrest drew attention not only from local media, but became a national sensation. The story of a hidden esoteric cult, ritual murders, and wealthy women using spiritual practices for manipulation sparked widespread interest across the country. National media quickly picked up the story. Journalists scrambled for information, digging into the pasts of both women and trying to understand how a secret esoteric society had been operating under the noses of local authorities for so long. Some speculated that there were deeper corruption ties protecting the cult members. The court hearing began in early November 2018 and immediately turned into a battle between the two defendants. Daria Cross, visibly weakened and broken, tried to justify her actions, claiming she had been under Lauren's control and feared punishment for disobeying the cult's rules. She asserted that it was Lauren who insisted on the ritual in Alex's death, threatening her with exposure and punishment from other members of the Circle of Renewal. Daria was in no position to make rational decisions. She was a victim of manipulation and intimidation by Lauren Mitchell and the entire occult society. "My client feared that if she didn't comply with their demands, her life would be in danger," her attorney said. Lauren Mitchell, however, conducted herself very differently in court. She denied any involvement in the ritualistic murder, claiming that Daria had independently decided on the sacrifice. Lauren argued that Daria acted out of her own motivations, trying to gain more influence in the Circle of Renewal. Lauren insisted she had no intention of killing Alex and did not participate in the ritual. "I never gave her orders. I didn't force her to kill anyone. It was her idea, her way of proving her loyalty to the cult. I wasn't even in the house that night," Lauren stated in court. The trial became a battlefield for both sides. Daria maintained her innocence, claiming that Lauren forced her into participating in the ritual. Meanwhile, Lauren vehemently denied all accusations, rejecting any involvement in the murder and insisting that Daria had chosen to conduct the ritual on her own to elevate her standing within the cult. It seemed both women were throwing accusations at each other, trying to avoid responsibility for Alex's death. But police and prosecutors continued to argue that both were inextricably linked to this horrific crime and the sect, which manipulated people for power and control. Testimonies from other members of the Circle of Renewal added even more confusing details. They described how Lauren and Daria participated in dangerous rituals, but noted that conflicts for leadership and influence within the cult often arose between them. These strained relations may have played a crucial role in the tragedy that occurred on the night of September 15th. The arrests and trial not only revealed the terrifying details of the occult rituals, but also the deep conflict between two women who manipulated each other in their pursuit of power and spiritual ascension. But who was truly the driving force behind this deadly game remained to be uncovered. The trial for the murder of Alex Harrington began on January 15, 2019, and quickly became one of the most talked about in the country. The courtroom was packed with journalists who eagerly awaited the dramatic showdown between the two defendants, Lauren Mitchell and Daria Cross. The case gained such widespread attention, not only because of the horrific circumstances of the murder, but also due to both women's connection to the Circle of Renewal. Lauren Mitchell's attorneys quickly assumed an active defensive stance. They put forth the argument that the entire story was nothing more than the product of Daria Cross's unstable mind, consumed by delusional ideas about fate and spiritual cleansing. To defend Lauren, her attorneys presented Daria's diaries, which were filled with mystical theories, ritual practices, and descriptions of her spiritual experiences. They used these writings as evidence to suggest that Daria had been obsessed with her esoteric fantasies and had orchestrated the murder herself. Throughout the trial, Lauren's lawyers attempted to distance their client from the crime, portraying her as a victim of Daria's manipulations. They insisted that Lauren had no involvement in the murder and that the entire idea for the ritual came from Daria, who, according to them, saw it as a way to achieve enlightenment and elevate her standing within the cult. However, the prosecution was determined not to let Lauren go unpunished. In court, evidence of her longstanding involvement in the Circle of Renewal was presented. Prosecutor Thomas Drake informed the court that Lauren was not just a participant, but in fact the leader of the sect. He provided numerous testimonies and documents showing that Lauren had actively used her power and influence to manipulate cult members, forcing them to participate in dangerous rituals and submit to her control. The most shocking twist came when the prosecutor revealed that Lauren Mitchell might be linked to the disappearance of several people from neighboring towns over the past 5 years. Documents and witness testimonies were presented in court, pointing to her involvement in suspicious rituals that coincided with these disappearances, strengthening the prosecution's case. Several former cult members also testified in court. They described Lauren as a charismatic but highly manipulative leader who used spiritual practices as a means of controlling their lives. Some recalled her talking about sacrifices necessary for the group to achieve their collective goals and the threats made against those who refused to comply. With each passing day, the trial grew more complicated. Lawyers on both sides continued to debate each woman's level of responsibility. But as more facts emerged, it became clear that both were deeply involved in the cult's activities and its brutal rituals. Finally, after several months of hearings and nearly a week of deliberations, on March 23, 2019, the court delivered its verdict. Daria Cross confessed to her role in Alex Harrington's murder. While the court acknowledged her confession, it also noted that she was not merely a victim of manipulation, but an active participant in the ritual. Daria was found guilty of premeditated murder and sentenced to life imprisonment without the possibility of parole. Lauren Mitchell was found guilty of complicity in the murder, as well as of creating and leading a sect that manipulated people through violence and rituals. She was also sentenced to life imprisonment without the possibility of parole. Thus concluded one of the most sensational trials of the year. Despite attempts by the defense to portray the case as a result of delusion and manipulation, justice was served. Both women behind this horrific conspiracy would face punishment for their crimes. After the verdict was delivered in March 2019, it seemed that the case of Alex Harrington's murder had reached its conclusion. But as soon became evident, this was only the beginning of a new chapter, an international investigation that would shake not only Willow Creek, but also other parts of the country and beyond. Immediately after the trial, federal agents launched a deeper investigation into the activities of the Circle of Renewal. Documents found in the homes of Lauren Mitchell and Daria Cross, as well as testimonies from former cult members, led to the uncovering of a vast network of followers across the country and abroad. It was revealed that this group was not merely engaged in spiritual practices and esoteric rituals, but had also practiced systematic psychological and physical abuse, manipulation, and control over its members' lives. The sect proved to be far more powerful than investigators initially thought. Dozens of participants were arrested, including entrepreneurs, spiritual leaders, and high-ranking individuals. These people had used occult practices to control both personal and business relationships, many of which had ended in disappearances or deaths. Authorities suspected that dozens of disappearances across the country might be linked to the activities of this society. For Alex's family, the revelation of this sect was a second blow. They had already endured the horrific loss of their son, but soon after the trial, they learned how deeply he had been drawn into the dark practices of the cult. In an interview, Alex's mother, Margaret Harrington, recalled, "We never knew that Alex could have been a part of something like this. It was a shock for us. We always thought he was just helping people, that he was a kind and bright soul." In memory of their son, the Harrington family decided to establish an organization that supports young people who find themselves in difficult situations and victims of manipulation. They believe that through this work, they can help others avoid the traps that Alex fell into. Willow Creek, once considered a quiet and prosperous suburb, now bore the stigma of scandal. After the revelation of the sect's practices and the arrests, residents began leaving their homes, fearing that the cult's influence might still be felt in the town's life. The town's economy suffered, many businesses closed, and people no longer felt safe. Local authorities reported that within the first 6 months after the trial, Willow Creek's population had decreased by 20%. A town that once thrived thanks to its wealthy residents and successful businesses had become a shadow of its former self. People no longer trusted one another, fearing that somewhere among them might still be cult followers. The story of Daria Cross, Lauren Mitchell, and Alex Harrington illustrates how dangerous the pursuit of spiritual power and control can become when it turns into an obsession. Reckless involvement in occult practices, manipulation, and playing on psychological vulnerabilities can easily turn life into a nightmare. This case serves as a reminder that spiritual practices and esoteric communities can become dangerous weapons in the hands of those willing to do anything for power. What began as spiritual ascension, culminating in a deadly ritual, became the final step for those consumed by the illusion of power over others. Psychologists and experts warn, when spiritual practices extend beyond reason and become tools for control and power, they transform into a threat. A cult that promises enlightenment can become a trap from which there is no escape. The story of Alex Harrington, Daria Cross, and Lauren Mitchell will remain as a tragic warning. It's not just a tale of sacrifice, but a story of how easily spiritual dependency can lead to catastrophe. Let this serve as a lesson to all who seek strength and control in the darkest corners of the human soul. Emily Grayson, 40 years old, was a respected teacher in Willow Creek. She was known for her kindness and dedication to her students, actively involved in charity work and community events. On the surface, her life seemed perfect, but behind this facade were personal struggles. Michael Grayson, 55 years old, a successful restaurant chain owner, spent much of his time working. His marriage to Emily appeared stable to outsiders, but in reality, their relationship had grown cold and distant. Townspeople had noticed that their family hadn't been as close as they once were. Jacob Grayson, 19 years old, their adopted son, was taken in by the Graysons after his mother's death. He had always been a quiet and withdrawn teenager. Over the years, he felt like an outsider in the family and gradually developed growing resentment toward his adoptive parents. Recent attempts to attend college were unsuccessful, and he withdrew further into himself, displaying troubling signs of detachment. In May 2019, Emily sought help from a family therapist due to the growing tension with Jacob and the strain in her marriage. That summer, after a serious argument, Jacob suddenly left home, further escalating the family's issues. Despite the outward appearance of normalcy, the tension in their home continued to build, laying the groundwork for the tragedy that soon followed. Emily Grayson was a prominent figure in the small town of Willow Creek. She started working as a teacher at the local middle school in 2005, quickly earning the respect of her colleagues and the love of her students. Her lessons were always engaging, and she took a personalized approach with each child. In 2012, she initiated the Second Chance program, helping troubled teens rehabilitate and successfully complete their education. Colleagues and parents praised her for her contributions to youth development, and city officials awarded her several times for her work in education. Emily was also heavily involved in town life. Each year, she organized charity events for families in need, raised funds for the local animal shelter, and often volunteered at various community events. In 2018, she became the head of the town's festival committee, organizing the largest City Day celebration in its history. Her energy and optimism inspired many, and on the surface it seemed that Emily was a happy and successful woman. Emily had been married to Michael Grayson, a successful restaurant chain owner, for 15 years. Their wedding in 2004 had been a major event in the small town of Willow Creek. Michael provided a luxurious lifestyle, a beautiful house with a garden, vacations at resorts, and dinners at the finest restaurants. But over time, their relationship began to change. Starting in 2015, friends began to notice that Michael was spending more and more time working or traveling. Emily was often left home alone, and a sense of emptiness began to take hold in her life. She rarely spoke about her feelings, and only her close friend Laura Miller knew that Emily's marriage hadn't been as strong as it appeared for quite some time. In recent years, the couple had grown apart, and this became especially noticeable in 2019 when Michael missed their anniversary, citing urgent business in another city. Neighbors noticed that Emily had become more withdrawn and introspective, and conversations about their perfect home life began to fade. Jacob had been adopted by the Graysons when he was 12 years old. In 2012, his mother, Emily's close friend, had died in a car accident. Emily and Michael decided to take him into their family, and at first, the relationship between him and Emily was warm. Emily saw in him a chance to give love, perhaps to fill a void she couldn't express in her marriage. She was actively involved in helping him adapt to his new life and focused on his education. However, as Jacob grew older, he became more withdrawn. By 2017, his behavior had changed. He began avoiding contact with his adoptive parents, spending more and more time alone in his room. Emily noticed that Jacob had started showing strange signs of attachment to her, which went beyond typical family relationships. He would often watch her, write down what she said, and even occasionally argue with Michael in her defense. Emily tried to understand his feelings, but grew increasingly anxious as the tension continued to rise. By 2019, Jacob, now 19, was experiencing deep emotional difficulties. His attachment to Emily had turned into an obsession. He began to display bouts of aggression and jealousy, particularly toward Michael, whom he felt didn't care enough about his adoptive mother. No one, including Emily, realized that this tension would soon escalate into something much darker and more dangerous. In the fall of 2018, Jacob turned 18. This was a turning point not only in his life, but also in his relationship with Emily. Jacob, who had always harbored strong feelings for her, began to see their relationship differently. In September 2018, Emily noticed that his attachment had become more intense, but she convinced herself that it was just a result of his trauma from losing his mother. The situation worsened in December 2018 when Emily, feeling increasingly lonely due to Michael's growing distance, found herself thinking more and more about Jacob. He had become her source of emotional support, something she had been missing in her marriage. By winter 2019, their relationship began to shift to a new level. In February, Jacob prepared a dinner for Emily while Michael was away on a business trip. This was one of the first times Jacob made a move toward closeness, and Emily, though hesitant, gave in to her emotions. They started spending more time together, walking through town, discussing books and movies, and even going shopping together. But by the spring of that same year, the tension between them had evolved into something more. In March 2019, Emily confided in her friend Laura that she felt confused and didn't know how to handle the new dynamic in her relationship with Jacob. She couldn't tell if it was purely emotional attachment or something much deeper. Between May and June 2019, everything became clear. They began meeting in secret, and their relationship became both romantic and psychologically dependent. Emily felt guilty and morally conflicted, but Jacob, in turn, became increasingly obsessed. He no longer saw her just as a mother figure, but as the object of his desires. Their relationship became something forbidden, something that was tearing apart both her inner world and his psychological state. Psychologists working on the case later noted that these relationships represented a complex psychological phenomenon. Emily, despite her role as a mother, found solace and youth in Jacob, something she could no longer find in her marriage. With each passing day, she became more emotionally dependent on Jacob, even though she was fully aware that these relationships violated every moral boundary. For Jacob, these relationships were far more painful. Psychologists explained his behavior as the result of deep trauma associated with losing his mother and his mixed feelings for Emily. He saw her as a mother, a woman, and an object of obsession. By the spring of 2019, his behavior became even more unstable. He was consumed by jealousy, especially when Michael was around. By the summer of 2019, those around Emily and Jacob began to notice strange behavior. Observant neighbors such as Caroline Steele, a close friend of Emily's, noticed that Jacob was spending more and more time with Emily. In June 2019, Caroline saw Jacob lingering at Emily's house several times, even when Michael was away on business trips. She also noticed that Emily seemed increasingly distracted and often avoided personal conversations. On a few occasions, Caroline overheard long emotional conversations behind closed doors, with voices growing tense. It started to worry her, but she had no idea that something much more serious was happening beneath the surface. Between July and August 2019, neighbors increasingly heard loud arguments coming from the Grayson household. Jacob grew more irritable, and when Michael returned from one of his business trips, he started noticing changes in Emily's mood. Observers noted that Jacob's behavior was becoming stranger. He began avoiding contact with neighbors, growing more aggressive and withdrawn. By late August 2019, the tension had reached its peak when Michael unexpectedly returned home early from a trip and found Emily and Jacob alone together. Emily tried to smooth things over, but Michael immediately sensed something was wrong. At that moment, their relationships began to unravel before their eyes, and Jacob started acting even more impulsively. October 18, 2019 began like any other day in quiet Willow Creek. Emily Grayson spent her morning at school, teaching as usual, and then headed home around noon. However, by evening, it became clear that something was wrong. At 7:30 p.m., Michael Grayson called the police, reporting that his wife was missing. He said that when he returned home, Emily was nowhere to be found, and he couldn't reach her by phone. Emily's usual routine included working in her art studio, located in the basement of their home, during the evenings. But this time, she wasn't there. When the police arrived, they immediately noticed the eerie silence and odd atmosphere in the house. There were no signs of forced entry, but something clearly felt off. Around 9 p.m., detectives descended into the basement, where Emily worked on her art. There, amidst scattered tools and unfinished canvases, they found her body. Emily lay on the floor, strangled with a rope. At first glance, the scene was arranged to look like a suicide. The rope was carefully tied to a shelf, and her body was positioned almost peacefully. But experienced detectives quickly noticed details that didn't add up. Emily's body bore multiple bruises on her wrists and neck, indicating she had fought back. Around her lay broken items, including sculptures and brushes, which clearly suggested a physical struggle. Near the body, they also found shoe prints that did not belong to either Emily or Michael. These small but crucial details made it clear to the police. This wasn't a suicide. It was a carefully planned murder, staged to look like one. The police launched an investigation with a meticulous examination of the crime scene. The following morning, October 19, detectives uncovered another crucial piece of evidence inside the house, Emily's diary hidden in her bedroom. This diary became a turning point in the case. In it, Emily detailed the last few months of her life, describing Jacob's strange and increasingly threatening behavior. She wrote about how she had begun to fear him, noting that Jacob often watched her at night and had become more aggressive in recent weeks. One of the entries, dated October 5, 2019, was particularly significant for the investigation. In it, Emily described an incident where she noticed Jacob watching her through the window of her studio late at night. She also wrote about her attempts to end their dangerous relationship and how Jacob refused to accept her decision. Emily was on the verge of despair, but was too afraid to tell Michael what was really going on. She even considered leaving town, but didn't know how to do so without completely destroying her family's life. The discovery of Emily's diary was an unexpected twist in the investigation. Now the police had evidence that the relationship between Jacob and Emily had been tense and dangerous. Investigators, who initially suspected possible motives tied to financial issues or marital disputes between Emily and Michael, shifted their focus to a new theory: premeditated murder by Jacob, driven by his obsession with Emily. According to data found on Jacob's phone, The police learned that shortly before the murder, on October 17th, there had been a heated exchange between him and Emily. Emily had firmly tried to end their relationship, stating that they couldn't continue this way and that she no longer wanted to hide the truth from Michael. In response, Jacob sent her a threatening message. "You can't just walk away. You belong to me." This text became a critical piece of evidence linking him to the murder. When the police questioned Jacob on October 20th, he initially denied any involvement in Emily's disappearance, claiming he hadn't seen her since the morning of October 18th. However, under the weight of evidence, the diary, text messages, and clues from the crime scene, his story began to fall apart. Detectives noticed that he grew increasingly nervous whenever the topic of his relationship with Emily came up, and by the end of the interrogation, it was clear that he was hiding something. On October 25th, 2019, exactly 1 week after Emily Grayson's tragic death, Willow Creek police received an emergency call from Michael Grayson's office. A company employee arriving for work in the morning found his lifeless body on the office floor. At first glance, it appeared to be a robbery. The office door had been forced open, papers were scattered across the floor, and the safe containing money and important documents had been emptied. Initially, investigators thought it was a random crime, but soon details emerged that pointed in a different direction. Michael had a hidden camera in his office, installed for security after recent threats against his business. When detectives reviewed the footage, they saw an unknown figure dressed in dark clothing and a mask enter the office just minutes before the murder. The person acted quickly and with purpose, dispelling the theory of a random burglar. Moreover, the way the killer moved suggested they knew exactly where the safe was and what documents to target. This was not typical of a robbery. It soon became clear that Michael's murder was connected to Emily's case. Detectives began to examine Michael's connections and return to his relationships with his wife and Jacob. It increasingly appeared that the two crimes were no coincidence and could be part of a larger, complex plan. As the investigation continued, a new and unexpected figure came to light. Sarah Wilson, a young woman who worked in the accounting department at Michael's company. At first, Sarah seemed like a typical employee, but after a more thorough examination of her phone records and messages, the police discovered that she had been involved with both Michael and Jacob. This revelation shocked everyone. It turned out that Sarah had been Michael's lover for quite some time, with their relationship beginning back in 2017. She frequently visited his office after work, and their affair remained a secret, even from those closest to them. But what was even more shocking, she was also involved with Jacob. In text messages dated during the summer of 2019, Sarah flirted with Jacob, and their conversations revealed that they discussed Emily and their plans for the future. Investigators concluded that Sarah might be the link between the two murders. On October 23rd, 2 days before Michael's death, Sarah met with Jacob at a cafe near his house. Surveillance footage captured them engaged in a lively conversation that lasted over an hour. This raised suspicions that they could have been planning their next steps after Emily's murder. Sarah was playing a dangerous game, manipulating both Michael and Jacob. She promised love and support to one while convincing the other that they could be together if Emily was out of the picture. However, by the fall of 2019, the situation had spiraled out of control. Emily's murder hadn't resolved the issues between Jacob and Sarah, and now they were entangled in a cycle of violence from which there seemed to be no escape. On October 28, 2019, 3 days after Michael Grayson's murder, detectives Leanne Blake and John Peterson began carefully analyzing the evidence and the connections between all the participants in the tragedy. Clues gathered from surveillance footage and mobile devices allowed them to slowly unravel the events. The police had already learned that Sarah Wilson was not just Michael's lover. She had also been skillfully manipulating Jacob, exploiting his emotional instability and obsession with Emily to execute her own sinister plan. The revelation of Sarah's motives marked an unexpected turning point in the investigation. As detectives reviewed her correspondence with Jacob, it became clear that she had intentionally preyed on his weaknesses. She gained his trust, using his feelings for Emily, convincing him that after Emily's death, they could be together and start a new life. These messages, dating from July and August of 2019, showed how Sarah methodically led Jacob toward the idea of killing Emily, convincing him that it was the only way out of their situation. Jacob, consumed by his passion for Emily and Sarah's promises, became the perfect pawn in her scheme. Sarah masterfully orchestrated the situation, leading Jacob to believe that eliminating Emily would free them both. In August 2019, she sent him a message that read, "We can only be together when this is all over. You know what needs to happen." These words became key evidence of Sarah's critical role in driving the events forward. Even after Emily's death, Sarah continued to manipulate Jacob, convincing him that they could start a new life together, but only after they dealt with one final obstacle, Michael. They held secret meetings where they discussed the next steps, and Jacob, now completely under Sarah's control, began planning the murder of his adoptive father. Sarah remained behind the scenes, continuing to use Jacob as her puppet. On October 22, 2019, just days before Michael's murder, Sarah began applying more pressure on Jacob. Their conversations were filled with mentions of how Michael supposedly suspected them, and that if they didn't act soon, their entire future would be destroyed. Sarah intensified the pressure, playing on Jacob's fears that he would lose her and end up alone. All of this led Jacob to commit the murder, believing he was acting out of love for Sarah and to protect their future. However, Sarah already had a different plan for the future. On October 25th, the day after Michael's murder, she began planning her escape. Her plans included eliminating Jacob to ensure there were no loose ends that could lead back to her. Sarah knew that Jacob would eventually start to panic and make mistakes, which could jeopardize her safety. She intended to stage his death as a suicide, tying up all the remaining loose ends. Sarah started looking for an opportunity to lure Jacob to a secluded location where she could execute her plan. In their final text exchange, dated October 26th, she suggested they meet at his parents' house, reassuring him that it would be their new beginning. As always, Jacob agreed, unaware that he was about to become her next target. However, the next day on October 27th, the police received an anonymous tip implicating Sarah in both murders. This call disrupted her plans. Detectives began closely monitoring her movements and intercepted several phone calls, which revealed that Sarah was planning to flee. On October 28th, just hours before her planned meeting with Jacob, the police arrested Sarah. On October 28, 2019, following Sarah's arrest, the police also detained Jacob. He was found in his apartment in a state of extreme stress and anxiety. Jacob did not resist arrest and appeared broken. Detectives noticed that he had started to realize the full scope of his actions. Sarah, on the other hand, remained cold and refused to admit to anything. The trial began on January 15, 2020. Sarah and Jacob faced charges for the murders of Emily and Michael Grayson. The prosecution built its case on the premise that Sarah was the mastermind, skillfully manipulating Jacob to achieve her goals. Prosecutor Jane McKenzie presented evidence showing that Sarah exploited Jacob's emotional instability to convince him to eliminate his adoptive parents, promising him a new life and love that in reality never existed. On January 19th, text messages between Sarah and Jacob were presented in court, revealing how she gradually pushed him toward the murders. These messages demonstrated just how calculated her tactics were, designed to completely control the young man. However, Sarah continued to insist on her innocence, claiming that she never intended to commit murder and that her relationship with Jacob had been misinterpreted. The trial turned into a psychological drama. The prosecution portrayed Sarah as a cunning manipulator whose influence over Jacob was so strong that he fully submitted to her will. Jacob was presented as a victim, a mentally unstable person who had become a puppet in the hands of an experienced manipulator. In court, surveillance footage was shown, capturing Sarah and Jacob discussing the murders just days before Michael's death. This footage had a profound impact on the jury. Sarah appeared nervous, trying to deny her involvement in the conspiracy, but her lies began to unravel as more evidence was presented. On January 25th, psychologists brought in for the trial testified that Jacob suffered from severe emotional problems stemming from childhood trauma and complicated relationships with his adoptive parents. However, his actions were largely attributed to Sarah's strong influence, as she expertly manipulated his mind and convinced him of the false necessity of committing the murders. On February 5th, 2020, Jacob unexpectedly gave shocking testimony. During interrogation, He confessed that he had been madly in love with Emily and had hoped that one day they could be together. He openly revealed that Sarah had exploited his obsession and promised him a new life if he helped her get rid of Emily and Michael. Jacob admitted that despite his love for Emily, he acted under Sarah's influence, and his perception of the situation had been completely distorted by her manipulations. This confession hit like a bombshell. Sarah, who had previously denied her involvement, looked shaken and tried to change her defense strategy, claiming that her statements had been made under pressure. But the evidence against her was too overwhelming. After several weeks of interrogations, expert testimony, and witness statements on February 20, 2020, the jury delivered their verdict. Jacob was found guilty of second-degree murder and sentenced to life in prison with the possibility of parole after 25 years. In his closing remarks, the judge emphasized that Jacob was a young man suffering from severe psychological disorders and that his actions were the result of deep psychological trauma and manipulation. Sarah, on the other hand, was sentenced to death. Her role as the mastermind and manipulator was deemed particularly egregious by the court. The verdict sparked intense debate in the community and became a shocking conclusion to this complex case. Born on August 15, 1958 in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, Lori Hel Bembenek grew up in an ordinary working-class family of Polish descent. From an early age, Lori displayed remarkable determination and a burning desire to make a difference in the world. Her dream was unusual for a girl at that time. She wanted to become a police officer. As a teenager, Lori developed an interest in justice and human rights, inspired by stories of valor and honor she heard in the news and saw in films. After graduating high school, Lori didn't let go of her dream. Her determination led her to join the Milwaukee Police Department in 1980 at the age of 22. It was a significant year for Lori, a time when her dreams began to take shape. However, the reality of working in law enforcement was not as romantic as she had imagined. While serving in the department, Lori faced strict discipline and unspoken rules that didn't always align with her idealistic view of the world. Quickly, Lori began to see the darker side of law enforcement. She was surrounded mostly by men, many of whom treated her with suspicion and disdain. The department's atmosphere was rife with sexism and hidden discrimination. During this time, Lori increasingly noticed that some officers broke the rules but avoided consequences due to their connections within the system. Lori's career in the police force ended as abruptly as it had begun. In August 1980, she was fired for allegedly filing a false police report. In reality, as Lori later claimed, her dismissal was a result of her outspoken protests against internal corruption and discrimination. She had filed complaints against her colleagues, pointing out their misconduct, which led to her being isolated. Her dream of becoming a police officer was shattered, and at 22, she found herself without a job or support from her former colleagues. After her dismissal, Lori went through a difficult period in her life. Losing her job with the police, she sank into depression and struggled to find new employment. During this time, she had to take whatever jobs she could to make ends meet, and her path unexpectedly led her into the world of entertainment. In October 1980, Lori landed a job at the famous Playboy Club in Lake Geneva, Wisconsin. Although her work primarily involved serving customers, her attractive appearance and confidence quickly made her popular with the club's patrons. She worked as a waitress in a skin-tight Playboy bunny outfit, a look that soon became part of her public image. However, Lori took no pride in this phase of her life. Her job at the Playboy Club was a means of survival during a challenging period. Inside, she still held on to her dream of a career in law enforcement, and she continued to fight for her right to justice, preparing to file a complaint over discrimination and her wrongful dismissal. This experience showed Lori just how harsh and unfair the world could be, but it also made her stronger and more determined to fight for her rights until the end. This turning point in her life became the beginning of a series of events that would forever change her destiny. After her dismissal from the police and brief stint at the Playboy Club, Lori Hel Bembenek began rebuilding her life. In December 1980, when her world seemed to be falling apart, Lori met Fred Schultz. Fred was a Milwaukee Police Department detective with 13 years of experience. He was 10 years older than Lori and had a reputation among his colleagues as a notorious partier. His love for nightclubs and dancing earned him the nickname Disco. Despite this, Fred was a seasoned detective and knew all the ins and outs of law enforcement, a world Lori was already familiar with. By that time, his marriage to Christine Schultz, his first wife, had collapsed. Their relationship had finally ended in November 1980 after 14 years together. Christine, the mother of their two sons, 11-year-old Sean and 8-year-old Shannon, had grown tired of Fred's endless infidelities. After the divorce, she gained full custody of the children and remained living in the home the couple had once shared. Fred, on the other hand, was left with significant alimony payments and had to support his sons. Lori and Fred quickly grew close. Their relationship developed rapidly, and just 1 month after meeting, they were married in January 1981. It was a whirlwind romance that seemed to pull Lori out of her depression and misfortune. Fred became more than just her husband. He represented her chance to start a new life. However, despite the passion between them, their marriage brought not only happiness, but also a host of problems related to Fred's past and financial obligations. As a detective, Fred earned a decent living, but a large portion of his income went toward alimony and supporting his former family. Each month, he paid Christine around $700, a substantial sum for that time. These obligations placed a significant strain on the young couple's budget. Lori soon realized that financial difficulties would cast a constant shadow over their relationship. By mid-1981, tension in their marriage began to escalate. In June, they were forced to move in with their friends, Judy Zess and her boyfriend, Tom Gertner, in order to cut expenses. Living in the same house as another couple only heightened the conflict related to their financial struggles. Lori became increasingly disillusioned with their marriage, as Fred continued paying alimony and could not fully support her dreams of a new life. Moreover, constant discussions about money and alimony became a growing source of irritation for Lori. Against the backdrop of these issues, Lori found herself increasingly consumed by thoughts of her failed career and the injustices she had endured. She was under constant pressure, both financial and psychological. The burden of money problems, along with the realization that she was living in the remnants of Fred's past, further eroded her patience. Despite these challenges, Lori and Fred held on to each other, trying to build a family life amidst financial woes and memories of the past. But soon their lives would take a drastic turn, a fateful event that would upend everything. On the night of May 28, 1981, what should have been an ordinary evening for the Schultz family turned into a nightmare. Around 2:15 a.m. in their southwest Milwaukee home, tragedy struck, forever altering the lives of everyone involved. That night, only Christine Schultz and her two sons, 11-year-old Sean and 8-year-old Shannon, were in the house. They were sleeping in their rooms when they were awakened by noise. Sean, the eldest, woke up first. In his half-asleep daze, he saw a strange figure in their home, a stranger with a red ponytail, wearing a green jacket and black boots that reminded him of the type worn by police officers. Sean quickly realized that this person was trying to tie him up, but he managed to break free. He screamed, waking his younger brother. The terrified boys rushed to their mother's bedroom, but it was already too late. When Sean reached her room, he found Christine lying face down on the bed, her wrists tied with ropes and a bandana wrapped around her mouth. Her body was still. Sean noticed a gunshot wound in her back, and a sense of dread overwhelmed him. He knew his mother was dead. When the police arrived at the crime scene, it was immediately clear that this was a cold-blooded murder. Christine had been shot at close range. The bullet pierced through her heart. The alarm had been raised by her boyfriend, Stuart Honick, who had been informed of the incident by one of the boys. Investigators focused on the details left at the scene: ropes, a bandana, and other small pieces of evidence. But the main question remained: who could have committed such a horrific crime? Suspicions quickly fell on Christine's ex-husband, Fred Schultz. Although he claimed to have been on duty, it soon became apparent that his alibi was questionable. Fred admitted that instead of working, he had spent the evening drinking at a bar with his partner, Michael Durfee. While his direct involvement in the murder couldn't be proven, another shocking detail emerged. The weapon used to kill Christine was his service revolver, a .38-caliber handgun that he kept at home. The investigation took a new turn when detectives shifted their focus to Lori Bembenek. The police began to suspect that she might have used Fred's revolver to commit the murder. One of the key factors was the lack of signs of forced entry at Christine's house, suggesting that the perpetrator might have had access to a key. It was known that Fred had made a copy of Christine's house key from their eldest son, Sean's key. This could explain how the intruder entered the house unnoticed. A crucial piece of evidence was a wig found in the plumbing system of the apartment Lori and Fred shared. The fibers from the wig matched those found on Christine's body. This discovery only increased suspicion against Lori. Additionally, hair found on the bandana used to bind Christine was consistent with hair from Lori's hairbrush. These pieces of evidence became the foundation of the prosecution's case, though Lori continued to maintain her innocence. However, not everything was clear-cut. Ballistics tests conducted on Fred's revolver, while initially matching the bullet retrieved from Christine's body, were later called into question. Some experts suggested that the test may have been flawed, raising doubts about the accuracy of the results. Serious concerns arose that the investigation might have been biased, particularly given that Lori had previously filed complaints about corruption within the Milwaukee Police Department. Despite the many questions and uncertainties, on June 24, 1981, Lori was arrested and charged with the murder of Christine Schultz. This arrest marked the beginning of a lengthy legal battle that would capture the attention of the entire nation. The public was shocked. A beautiful young woman, a former police officer and Playboy model, was now accused of a cold-blooded killing. But for Lori, this was only the beginning of her long fight for justice. Lori Bembenek's trial began in February 1982 in Milwaukee County Court, Wisconsin. The case garnered massive public interest. A former police officer accused of cold-bloodedly murdering her husband's ex-wife became the centerpiece of one of the most scandalous trials of the decade. Lori entered the courtroom under the watchful eyes of reporters and the public, eager to uncover the truth about what had happened on that fateful night in May 1981. The prosecution built its case around several key points. Prosecutors argued that Lori's motive for killing Christine Schultz was jealousy and financial troubles. They painted Lori as a woman embittered by the presence of her husband's ex-wife, who forced him to pay $700 a month in alimony, severely straining the couple's finances. Prosecutors insisted that Lori decided to murder Christine to free herself and Fred from these burdens and achieve financial independence. At the trial, much of the focus was on the physical evidence that prosecutors claimed left no doubt about Lori's guilt. First, the murder had been committed with Fred Schultz's revolver, which was kept at Lori's home and was accessible to her on the night of the murder. Prosecutors argued that Lori knew about the key to Christine's house that Fred had, allowing her to enter without any signs of forced entry. One of the most significant pieces of evidence was the wig found in the plumbing system of Lori and Fred's apartment. Fibers from the wig matched those found on Christine's body. Prosecutors argued that Lori wore this wig to disguise herself as a man with a long red ponytail, the same figure Christine's children had seen on the night of the murder. Additionally, hair found on the bandana used to bind Christine matched hair from Lori's hairbrush. Prosecutors claimed this was further proof of her involvement. The prosecution also cited witness testimonies from people who claimed to have heard Lori threaten Christine before her death. According to them, Lori had repeatedly expressed a desire to get rid of Fred's ex-wife. Lori's defense team built their case around the argument that all the evidence against her was circumstantial and insufficient for a conviction. Her lawyers argued that the investigation had been plagued by numerous irregularities and that the police might have deliberately framed Lori due to her conflicts with the department. They maintained that much of the evidence, including the wig and hair, could have been fabricated or mishandled. Specifically, the defense pointed to the possibility that evidence had been planted to divert suspicion away from the real killer. One of the defense's main arguments was that Fred Schultz himself might have been involved in the murder of his ex-wife. Lori claimed that Fred had lied to the police about his whereabouts on the night of the murder and that his alibi, being at a bar with his partner, was unreliable. However, despite this, the court did not pursue the theory of Fred's involvement, focusing instead on the charges against Lori. One of the most controversial aspects of the case revolved around the eyewitness testimonies. For instance, Christine's eldest son, Sean, had seen the intruder that night but could not definitively identify Lori as the killer. He described the person as having a red ponytail, which he assumed belonged to a man, something that did not match Lori's appearance at the time, as her hair was blonde. The defense argued that this fact pointed to a mistaken identification of the perpetrator. Nevertheless, the prosecution relied on other witness testimonies, including a statement from one of Lori's friends who claimed she had offered money for Christine's murder. On March 9, 1982, after an extensive trial, the jury delivered its verdict. Lori Bembenek was found guilty of first-degree murder. She was sentenced to life imprisonment at the Tayshida Correctional Institution in Fond du Lac, Wisconsin. The verdict sparked a wave of emotions in the public. Some believed that justice had been served, while others were convinced that Lori had fallen victim to a corrupt system and injustice. However, for Lori, this conviction was not the end, but the beginning of her long fight for freedom and to clear her name. In the following years, she would file several appeals, trying to have the case reviewed and the murder charges against her dropped. After her conviction in 1982, Lori Bembenek found herself in a maximum security prison, Tayshida Correctional Institution in Fond du Lac, Wisconsin. This place became her home for the next 8 years. Despite the harsh conditions, Lori didn't let prison life break her spirit. She always maintained her innocence and held on to hope for justice. In prison, Lori kept herself busy with self-education. She earned a bachelor's degree from the University of Wisconsin-Parkside and even started a prison newspaper, which helped her stay occupied and connected to the outside world. She drew strength from the letters of support she received and the growing media interest in her case. Lori became a figure who garnered increasing sympathy from the public. Many believed she had become a victim of an unjust judicial system. However, her appeals were consistently denied. Her defense team repeatedly sought to have the case reopened, citing new facts and questionable evidence on which the conviction was based, but they were unsuccessful. Lori felt increasingly cornered, realizing that justice might never be served. The summer of 1990 marked a turning point in Lori's life. She grew close to Dominic Guglietti, the brother of one of the inmates, who helped her devise a plan for escape. This relationship became a source of inspiration and hope for Lori's freedom. Together, they planned an escape that shocked many for its boldness and precision. On July 15, 1990, Lori made a desperate move. She escaped from Tayshida Correctional Institution using a simple yet effective plan. While performing her prison duties in the laundry, she crawled through a window and then scaled a 7-foot barbed wire fence. At that moment, Dominic was waiting for her in a car outside the prison. This moment marked the culmination of her long efforts to break free. After the escape, Lori and Dominic fled to Canada. They hid out in Thunder Bay, Ontario, where they started a new life under false identities. However, their freedom was short-lived. Lori's story quickly caught the attention of both American and Canadian media. The program America's Most Wanted aired an episode about her, which led to an increase in citizen participation in the manhunt. Soon after, a tourist recognized Lori in a restaurant and reported her to the authorities. On October 17, 1990, Lori and Dominic were arrested by Canadian police after 3 months on the run. In Canada, Lori fiercely resisted extradition to the United States, sparking yet another wave of public interest in her case. Canadian authorities stated that Lori's transfer back to the U.S. would only be possible under the condition of a new trial. This development became a significant milestone for Lori and her legal team, as it meant her case was given a second chance. Lori's escape had turned her into a symbol of the fight against injustice. In Milwaukee, thousands of people rallied in support of her, viewing her escape as an act of defiance against a corrupt system. A few weeks after her escape, a rally was held in a city park under the slogan, "Run, Bambi, Run." Over 200 people gathered to show their solidarity with Lori, many wearing t-shirts bearing the slogan. Lori had transformed into a kind of folk hero, symbolizing the struggle for freedom and justice. The media began to cover her case from a new perspective. A growing number of people began questioning whether Lori was truly guilty or if she had been the victim of police corruption and a judicial mistake. Public support grew, and Lori came to be seen more and more as a victim of wrongful prosecution. Her escape only heightened this image, adding even more drama to her story. After her arrest in Canada in the fall of 1990, Lori Bembenek became the center of international attention. Canadian authorities were reluctant to extradite her back to the U.S. without conditions. They required that Lori be granted a new trial upon her return. This development marked a turning point in Bembenek's case. Her defenders, led by human rights lawyers, actively lobbied for a review of her case in the United States, pointing out the errors made during the original investigation and trial. On April 22, 1991, Lori voluntarily returned to the U.S., where a new phase of her fight began. Judicial authorities agreed to reopen the case, which was a significant victory for Lori and her attorneys. This meant that, perhaps a decade after Christine Schultz's murder, the truth might finally come to light. As the case was reconsidered, key pieces of evidence that had led to Lori's conviction were re-examined. The focus shifted to the ballistics tests and forensic analyses, which had raised doubts during the initial trial. New analyses suggested that the results of the previous tests might have been unreliable. Additionally, questions arose regarding the wig and hairs found at the crime scene, which had been central to the evidence against Lori. One of the key developments was the emergence of new information regarding possible sexual assault before the murder, which had not been considered in the original trial. Moreover, it was suggested that the bullet retrieved from Christine's body may have been fired from a different weapon than Fred Schultz's revolver. These doubts became the foundation for re-examining the charges, as it became clear that the investigation may have been biased and rushed. After many legal battles and the introduction of new facts, prosecutors offered Lori a deal. In December 1992, she agreed to plead guilty to a lesser charge, second-degree murder. This allowed her to avoid further prison time, as her sentence was reduced to 20 years, of which she had already served 11, including her time after arrest and while in Canada. She was immediately released after striking the deal. For Lori, this was a difficult compromise. She accepted guilt for a crime she maintained she did not commit, but it granted her the long-awaited freedom. After her release, Lori tried to return to a normal life. In 1996, she moved to Washington State, where she attempted to start a new chapter, away from the public eye. In the years that followed, Lori continued to fight for complete exoneration. She filed appeals in court, seeking new genetic testing on the remaining evidence, but these efforts were rejected. She pushed for DNA testing on the hairs and other evidence that could definitively prove her innocence, but the results did not lead to a review of her case. Despite all the hardships, Lori continued to fight for her name. She wrote an autobiographical book titled Woman on Trial, in which she recounted her experiences and the challenges of her fight for justice. Her health gradually declined due to years of stress and imprisonment. In 2002, Lori completed her probation, officially closing her criminal case. Lori's health continued to decline, and in 2010, at the age of 52, she passed away from liver failure. Until her death, Lori maintained her innocence and continued to seek ways to fully clear her name. Despite all the hardships she faced, she remained a symbol of the fight for justice for many people who believed in her innocence. Lori Bembenek's story remains one of the most mysterious and controversial legal dramas in American history. Her life, from dreaming of a career in law enforcement to her dismissal, murder conviction, and dramatic prison escape, captivated the public and the media for decades. Even after her death in 2010, questions about whether she was truly guilty or if she was made a scapegoat continue to linger. On one hand, the prosecution portrayed her as a cold-blooded killer motivated by jealousy and financial troubles. Evidence such as the wig found in her home's plumbing, matching hairs, and Fred Schultz's revolver played a decisive role in her conviction. However, on the other hand, doubts about the quality of the investigation, potential errors and falsified evidence, as well as suspicions of police corruption linked to her complaints about department misconduct, cast a shadow over the entire process. Many believed Lori had become a victim of a system seeking an easy scapegoat to close a high-profile case. Her prison escape and life on the run only deepened this duality. On one hand, her escape was seen as confirmation of her guilt, but on the other, for many, it became a symbol of a desperate struggle for justice. In 1990, the slogan, "Run, Bambi, Run," became a rallying cry for the movement for the rights of the wrongfully convicted. Public opinion was split. Some saw Lori as a dangerous criminal, while others viewed her as a victim of a broken justice system. Lori Bembenek passed away on November 20, 2010 from liver failure, leaving behind many unresolved questions. She died without ever achieving full exoneration, but her case left a lasting mark on American culture and jurisprudence. Lori's story inspired books, documentaries, and TV shows, including episodes in popular programs like America's Most Wanted and Unsolved Mysteries. Her fight for justice became an example for other cases involving claims of wrongful convictions. Her legacy continues to be discussed in legal circles as an example of how the justice system can go wrong and how important it is to incorporate new technologies, such as DNA testing, which can shed light on old cases. Her story also serves as a crucial lesson about the ways political and social factors can influence criminal proceedings. In some circles, Lori is seen as a victim of a time when women in law enforcement faced immense pressure and discrimination. Her battle against police corruption, which may have led to her prosecution, remains a symbol of resilience and determination. Lori Bembenek's case had a significant impact on public opinion. It once again raised questions about the fairness of the American justice system and highlighted potential issues within police investigations. Many began to recognize how complex the pursuit of truth can be under the pressures of public and media scrutiny. Lori's story became a catalyst for discussions about criminal justice reform, particularly in cases involving questionable evidence and potential law enforcement bias. In the legal community, Lori Bembenek's case is regarded as a lesson in the importance of safeguarding the rights of the accused and ensuring that evidence is thoroughly examined. Her case has become part of a broader conversation about judicial errors and how they can be prevented in the future.